My name is Jenna Hutchison, and I'm a nephrology social worker with DaVita, and as the lead role for one of our operating divisions in the Bay Area, and I work with Deborah.
And I'm the clinical services specialist at DaVita. I cover a territory from San Francisco down to Redwood City and up to Hawaii. And yes, I really do work when I'm in Hawaii. Everyone thinks I'm there on a vacation.
So we're going to talk today and really want to make this interactive about effective interdisciplinary teamwork. I think especially within the nephrology setting, there is such a big emphasis on the IDT. And I wanted to find out first, just to get an idea of who we're talking to. Do we have nurses in the room? Okay. Nurses, all right. What about social workers? All right. Physicians? All right. Any dietitians? Anybody else that I'm missing? Just to help us kind of gauge relevant information. So just to talk about really quickly the objectives is first, we want to really have a good understanding of how the IDT came to be in the conditions for coverage for CMS, define who constitutes the IDT, because I think sometimes there's assumptions or misunderstandings about that, and look at contributing factors and strengths of a high-functioning interdisciplinary team, and also understand some of the common obstacles to team development. And at the end, we're hoping to have some time to try to troubleshoot some of those obstacles.
So for the conditions of coverage, these regulations are what the dialysis facility follows. And I'm sure all of you are very, very familiar with them. They were revised in April of 2008. There's 166 pages of them. Then we have the interpretive guidance, which was released in October of 2008, and there's 299 pages of those, which cover the 16 conditions. And each condition has numerous B tags underneath it. So we won't be quoting all of them, but we'll quote one. So the IDT team is responsible for providing each patient with an individualized and comprehensive assessment of his or her needs, which is VTAG 501. And so the IDT encompasses a nephrologist, a nurse, a dietitian, a social worker, and the patient or the patient's representative. So a lot of times what happens is people think that they're having an IDT team meeting, but the physician isn't present. That would be a core team meeting. You have to have the physician present to have an IDT team meeting, which is an interdisciplinary team. It used to be, in the old conditions of coverage, it was called a multidisciplinary team. And at that point, the way it was interpreted was that everyone did their part, and then eventually it was gone over in the care plan. So what the interdisciplinary team means is that you meet as a group, you discuss the care of the patient, and your decisions are based on that. Now, the patient is an integral part of this. In many clinics, I do a lot of auditing. The patients don't realize that. So the patient can be there present physically, or you can have them phone in. We are required, and our surveyors now are following up on making sure that our patients at least are aware that they can go to these meetings, and that we should have some kind of documentation in their medical record that they were invited. They are not required to be there. So if they don't want to come, they don't have to, but we still need to make sure that we are inviting them. So back on those conditions of coverage, the interdisciplinary team is mentioned 200 times, so it's really an important thing that we follow.
All right, so I just wanted to touch, we're going to go over some common traits, and I definitely want to say this is not an all-inclusive list, so just go through some of the common traits of a strong interdisciplinary team, break them down one by one. I think confidence, first and foremost, everybody as professionals need to have a trust in ourselves, we need to have a trust in our professional judgment, and also, equally as importantly, we need to have that trust in our other team members as well. Without that trust, we really get stuck. People aren't sure that somebody's going to follow through. So having that trust means that I know that I'm going to say this, and we're going to get, basically the confidence is that we're all going to do what we say we're going to do. We're all going to present the true, accurate information for our patients. With communication, Yeah, so it means a connection with, I think, the base level. That means a connection between people. If we lack that communication with the interdisciplinary team, everybody works in their silo, separate. Nobody's sure who's doing what, and we don't have that. We could all be working in 5 different directions. We could all be working in the same direction and duplicating work without realizing it. I think also an important piece of communication is it needs to be open and honest. If we're not able to have those tough conversations, whether we agree or disagree with somebody, it really can put the brakes on the disciplinary team as a whole. And it should be really direct. You say what to do. We're going to make sure that it gets done, as opposed to kind of that circular communication where things don't actually end up ever being said and people are left wondering what's actually going on. And I think also, really most importantly too, communication needs to be patient-centered. The patient, I like to think of it, the patients in the driver's seat who are talking in the car and they're taking us where they need to go. We need to make sure that we have the patient at the center of everything that we're doing. So then collaboration goes along with it. I think it's especially because what Deborah said earlier with the old conditions for coverage, it was the multidisciplinary team and it's now the interdisciplinary team. We are working together. Everybody on the interdisciplinary team comes from a different background. So we've got the physician, the nurse, the dietitian focusing on different parts of the clinical issues of the patient. The social workers, they're focusing on the psychosocial issues, and the patients really know they're the expert on themselves and want to make sure that we're all, as the rest of the members of the team, are doing what we need to do to support them. So then rapport is also really important. And rapport is a close relationship where all parties understand each other. And having that rapport allows us, again, to go back to that open and honest communication, the directness, the confidence in each other. It really builds into that. The respect, again, it goes back to kind of confidence, that we've got confidence in each other, but also we respect each other, we respect what we're saying, we respect the positions of where we're all coming from, and respect what each discipline, each person brings to the team. Without that respect, again, it makes it hard for the team to function cohesively. And people's opinions, often, if you don't respect them, you may not honor their opinion. So then empathy, and this is, sometimes people hear me throw around the word empathy and think that it's more touchy-feely, but it's the identification with or vicarious experiencing of the feelings of another, and I want to make really sure it's not sympathy. People can use them interchangeably, and we can empathize with each other as a team, empathize with our patients without sympathizing for them, and really the, I think, important thing for us to have that kind of, that understanding of is that it's a really uphill struggle for dialysis patients. It's not an easy thing that we're asking them to do on a day-to-day basis. And for the team to have that acknowledgement and that understanding. So with customer service, I think especially within the team, as the patient at the driver's wheel of the car, is that we're wanting to make sure that all patients are treated equally. Sometimes I think if people sit back and reflect in their clinics and their practice, you can think of, oh, that's the patient that's X and this one's Y, but I really like that one, but that one's challenging. And that, having those labels really can overshadow how you interact with that patient, whether or not you realize it. So we all, we kind of think the quote unquote, I'm sure you all have a difficult or challenging patient that comes to mind. And just think if you need to approach them about something, how you might feel differently than if you were approaching somebody who you think, oh, that's a great patient, they're an easy patient, they're the quote-unquote perfect patient that everybody likes. And patients can pick up on that. They pick up on if we're interacting with them differently. So accountability is being answerable to your peers and your patients. And it's really, we're all accountable to follow through with our plan of care. The social worker is, the nurse is, the dietitian is, the patient is. It provides that parameter of care, and again, linked back to trust. I think so many of these things are really all very interconnected. And then fun. Part of it, we're DaVita employees, we have to throw it out there. But I think fun is really important. And we can have fun with each other, with our patients, without crossing over that line of professionalism. it's important to recognize and honor the appropriate boundaries. But doing fun things like playing bingo in the clinic with your patients on the holiday or celebrating good lab values with the patient commission, things like that can help impact the relationship that you have with each other, and just that makes it a little bit more easygoing to be coming to dialysis. To finish off my bit here, is the team is really a safe and respectful place to discuss the obstacles that patients facing. And the trust allows every team member to support each other and plan that effective care, which hopefully should result in effective care plans and ultimately send positive ripples to the entire facilities. Because when we're talking about the IDT, we are not including in there the patient care technicians, who are also really important and probably the ones that spend the most time with our patients. So I think, you know, if the IDT is on board and is interactive and engaged with each other, that ripples out to the PCTs as well.
So then we have the barriers when we don't have a perfectly functioning IDT team. And I'm sure many of you have experienced some of these. You have personality clashes with other members of the team. Some of them you just don't like. There's always time. How often does the physician say, no, I've got to cancel today, I don't have time. So these are also major barriers that we run into. We're focusing on problems instead of on the whole patient. We're working in silos. You know, the nurses are getting all wrapped up in clinical things, the social workers over here, the doctors over here. So, and then we have cross-cultural communication challenges, which, based on all of the experiences we've had this morning, you see all the different problems with those, from languages to how people perceive death and dying. So, since we're all in an area where there are so many different languages and cultures that we deal with on a daily basis. So, personality clashes. We can't expect everyone's personalities to mesh. We can overcome this by being respectful. So that's probably one of the things that I've learned in my experiences in the clinics, is that I see politeness works very well, but you should never be angry. You just have to be professional. Some of the examples to consider is the person that does all the talking, can't get a word in edgewise. The person that is always negative. The person that projects problems onto someone else. You know, it's not my fault they don't come for the treatments. But no, it's not your fault, but we need to figure out how we can get them there so that they do come for their treatments. What's the barrier? Why isn't the patient coming for their treatments? So then you have, you know, we can't expect everyone to like each other. We should expect professionalism and respect. I think respect is probably the biggest thing with the IDT team, because we want to maintain trust in the team. So you have to consider the patient and the barriers that they have. They're always coming in late, their lab values are not within normal length, within normal limits, they're disruptive, or you always have that perfect patient. Everything is perfect with them. So those are some of the things that, you know, we have to deal with. Time. This is probably the most infamous barrier. There's never enough of it. There's never a good time. And we need to make the time work. So we need, probably one of the best things we can do is if you can get your physicians to put up a standing schedule. If they can come like every third Thursday of the month, you could probably work around all your initial assessments and plans of care along something like that. And if you could just get them to commit to coming in once a month, you can probably keep everything on time. Then, once you do, you should probably set up an agenda and you need to stick to it. Just like we have a timekeeper here in our meetings, it would be great if we had a timekeeper in the IDT team so that we can keep things going. I had one physician that we always reserved the entire morning because he had 30 patients, it took 4 hours. The other physician had 30 patients and we were done in 30 minutes. Both did an excellent job. One was very much a driver, knew exactly what he wanted. He had it set up to where, you know, he would come in, give me the chart, what's going on with this patient, what are we going to do, this is what we're going to do, you get this, you get that, order this, we'll take care of that, let me write this, and we were done. I mean, each patient took no more than 5 minutes. Where the other one, we discussed everything from their sex life down to what they were eating for dinner. I mean, we talked about everything. Like I said, both were great care plan meetings, but you know, it would have been nicer if we could have kept the 4-hour ones a little shorter. So, and then you have your core team versus your IDT. So your IDT team is with your physician, as I said earlier, and you should be meeting with them, which would be great if you could do it once a month, and you would keep up on all of your care plans and assessments. But your core team, which is your nurse, your dietitian, and your social worker, and usually your FA, if they're available, would be great if they met on a weekly basis and you discuss some of the issues that you had going on in the clinic with all of your patients. Because if you do this, then you have a very good pulse on what's going on in the clinic and your clinic will run much smoother. And you'll keep your patients in a good place. So their outcomes will stay within those normal limits. So if we only focus on the negative, we'll alienate the patient. We want patients are more than their lab values. So while their lab values may not be perfect, we do want to find something that we can give them a boost on. And we want to root out the causes of, you know, why things aren't going where they're at. We also want to empower our patients so that they can make good decisions and we can keep them on positive track. So then as Jenna mentioned silos. When you work in a silo, you don't have communication. You probably will end up duplicating your work because everyone is working on the same problem. Or you may miss something that's really important. So collaboration is missing, and that's really the key because everybody brings something to the table. Everyone has a little bit different perspective. The nurses and the doctor, as we said, usually try to focus on the clinical things, but the social worker focuses on the other things. So it may be that a patient isn't getting, you know, good nutrition because they don't have enough money to buy groceries. So if the dietitian goes out there and talks to the patient about eating more, he'll say yes, 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 yes. But if the social worker goes out there and talks to the patient and he goes, I don't have any money, she may be able to find a source of funding so that he can get groceries. And then you'll get better nutrition. So there's, you know, many different things that you can do when you work collaboratively. And then for our cross-cultural differences, we have, as we've discussed heavily today, many different communication styles, especially when a language barrier is involved. There are many different attitudes towards conflict. I personally come from a family where you do everything really directly. You know, we're Northern European, there's no touchy-feely involved, you don't touch, you don't hug, you just get it off your chest. Then there's, you know, there's the Latin cultures where, you know, there's, you know, much, you know, it's not quite so emotionless. So there's many different attitudes towards conflict and communication and approaches to completing tasks. I tend to want to get them done immediately, and then you have your procrastinators that next week is fine. And so you want to be able to bring all of this together. Decision-making styles, you know, is the patient's caregiver making the decisions? Or do they believe that, you know, their physician should make the decisions and they'll just go along with whatever their physician tells them to do? So we also have attitudes towards disclosure, as we discussed this morning. You have where the family doesn't want the patient to know what's going on. And then you have just the opposite, where the patient wants to know what's going on, but the family doesn't want them to know. So there's all different kinds of attitudes towards disclosures. And then just different approaches to knowing. So, important skills. We have active listening and motivational interviewing. So this is probably difficult because we all hear, but we don't all listen. So when you're listening, you want to pay attention. You want to make eye contact with the people that are talking so that they know that you're paying attention. You want to provide feedback. So if there's something they're saying that isn't clear to you, you want to make sure that you let them know. You want to defer judgment. You may not like what they're saying, but you know, you should listen to what they're saying and defer your judgment until later, until you've heard everything that they have to say. And you want to respond appropriately, which is why you want to defer judgment, because you don't want to speak out of anger or frustration. And then we have motivational interviewing, which Jenna will give you some pointers on that.
So there is so much that you can talk about in motivational interviewing, and I've done, you know, there's a lot of different trainings and different pieces of it, and I think I just tried to distill it down a bit.
with some of the tenets and the things that I use most often when I'm doing motivational interviewing, and that's really it, going back to the open-ended questions, and also I'm thinking relating some few people in here were in the breakout group that I was at just before about the advanced communication skills, but asking those open-ended questions. You're listening to those answers. If you're asking yes, no's, you're not gonna get very far. Affirmations, I think that that is something that is really, really important to do as a team. And Deborah spoke earlier about, you know, we have patients, their lab values aren't this, or, you know, different things. You're not fitting into your nice neat boxes of what you would like them to look like, but they're coming to treatment. They're staying there the whole time. Look for the positives in there and reward those positives. Really speak to those positives, because that can help to build self-confidence and to give them that you're noticing that you're noticing that they are doing something good, and then you can work to build upon that. And the reflective listening. You know, so it sounds like I hear you saying, or I think I heard you saying, it sounds like you're feeling really frustrated. And another one that fell off the slide deck, I apologize, but it's about the scaling questions too, which is, you know, where do you think you are with making whatever changes that you guys are talking about? So let's say we're talking about where you think you are with controlling your phosphorus levels, being one of those struggles that we come across really frequently in the dialysis world. You know, on a scale of 1 to 10, how well do you think you're doing right now? And whatever the response is that you get, you really celebrate that response by saying, hey, you know, you said a 3, you're not a 2, so a 3 is great. And then moving forward from that, what would it look like for you to get to a 4 or 5? What would that mean to you? How would you know that? So that's another really big piece of motivational interviewing to use. And again, there's a lot more out there. We were just trying to come up with, you know, concise. And I think we have the breakout groups, but before we get to those, I just wanted to go back and speak a little bit about the IDT, especially as it relates to the theme of today's conference about the palliative decision making and what is important to do when we hear patients that are verbalizing, I just don't think I can do this anymore. I want to stop doing this. I hate doing this. As the team, I think a lot of times when patients verbalize that makes a lot of people really nervous. And I know in some of the clinics that I've worked in, it's been, oh, let me go get the social worker for you. Let me go get the social worker talking. That's definitely a good thing, but I think it discounts the fact that the patient has chose to say that to you. And to really take the time to acknowledge and understand what they're saying and where they're coming from, and connecting on that human level. That, yeah, it sounds like you're really struggling right now. You know, I hear that you're saying that you don't like this, that you hate this, that coming here is horrible. And, you know, I hear you saying that, and I want to make sure that I can give you the support, and then use that to get the segue in for the team. And again, the social worker, you know, can talk with the patient, and after you talk with the patient, if you don't loop in the physician with that, then you're not closing the loop as well.
Yeah. How do you handle, I work in a hospital, so okay. How do you handle a different aspect of it where you have a physician who's, you've got a patient who's obviously very sick, very declining, poor functionality, and that physician not entering in a conversation with the family or the patient about scaling back, and it's totally appropriate and becomes the flogging the dead horse type of thing. We see that a tremendous amount. Yeah. And do you see that in the outpatient setting?
Yes.
How do you handle it with that physician? Does the team approach that physician?
Yeah, and so I think the first thing, if in the outpatient setting, if a patient started talking about wanting to terminate dialysis, we trigger what's called an unstable assessment, which basically just means that aside from the normal course of assessments that we do periodically for our patients, we say, okay, something major's changed, the whole team needs to take a look at it and really dive in deep to it. And so that then triggers the care plan conference with the IDT, with the doctor included, and that's a chance for the nurse to say, this is you know, how the patient's presenting with dialysis, this is what they're doing, and the dietitian would say, yeah, their albumin is really dropping really low, we're really worried about this, and the social worker can bring in and say, yeah, the patient doesn't feel it's adding to their quality of life anymore. And oftentimes it's very helpful to have the patient part of that conversation, because then the whole team is there around the table. In the area that I work in, a lot of times the physicians join in by phone, and that makes it a bit more challenging than it does in person, but it's still, because the doctor has to be part of that conversation, it's about making sure that we are all in the same room, even if it's remotely in the same room, to have those conversations. There still may be times where you don't feel like you're getting that traction with the doctor. Some of the doctors, some of the nephrologists that I work with, and I don't want to generalize to all nephrologists, but some very much full patient, full, you know, I'm going to look at everybody in whole, very broad scope, and others are milks or kidneys, and every, you know, everything in between. And so sometimes getting the primary care doc involved in that conversation too can be really helpful, especially if that patient's particular nephrologist has that very narrow scope to say that if it's not really about their kidneys, then it's not me to deal with, it needs to be somebody else. And so I've had times where I've had the primary care doc join in on the teleconference care plans as well with the nephrologists and the patients. That way we can really, as a team, come to an understanding. And I always am there as well to make sure the patient's voice doesn't get lost in that discussion, because I think sometimes it can be really intimidating for our patients to have this team of professionals sitting around the table all throwing off our medical jargon like we really like to do, and patients, you know, can be intimidated by that. So about us to check for understanding, to make sure, have you heard, you know, is there anything else you want to say? You know, I want to make sure that we're articulating what your thoughts and wishes are. Can you please, you know, let us know if we're misstating something, taking that time. So I think it, you know, in the case where you come in to that wall, it's about looking at the other supports, the other professionals outside of dialysis. Does that answer your question for you?
We have a lot of dwindling patients who really need to have that discussion sooner rather than later, and we find out a lot of times that we're dialyzing in the ICU, and you know, there's certain nephrologists that will tell the family that to stop dialysis, well, the patient's going to die, you know, and then we get a palliative care consult, and we really have to say, well, the patient's going to die with or without dialysis, this is where the patient is going right now, and how best can we support and keep that patient comfortable. But there are nephrologists that are very, they're very controlling with what they say to the families, and I think it does the families and the patients a disservice. They don't step back and give them permission to say no.
Mm-hmm. And it does. I think you get, just for everybody, for all professions, you get a big spectrum. And it is. I think palliative care, depending on the area, I mean, in the hospital, it sounds like you have access to a palliative care team. In the area where I work, there's very minimal outpatient palliative care, depending on the insurance that the patient has, but definitely palliative care can be very helpful with those conversations too, with interfacing and helping to give that permission to the patient to stop. Because sometimes it is about permission, that if you're telling them this is what you have to do versus that, you know, it's okay, it's a choice, you can't choose to do something else, that permission can be a pretty powerful thing. Yeah. It's not an easy situation though when you run into that.
Yeah, kind of along those lines, by the time the patient gets in the hospital, the ICU, these big decisions are being discussed and made, it's really nice to know all that's going on in the background. And you mentioned that if you don't have the teams, you're in silos, but there you are in a silo. So is there any discussion about when a patient is admitted to the hospital, communicating some of the efforts of your disciplinary team to the disciplinary team now addressing probably those same concerns in the hospital?
I think that ideally that should be happening, definitely. There does seem to be a disconnect. I know as a social worker, sometimes I don't find out if patients in the hospital until and I don't know if with the advent of the new health insurance, the HIVs, the information where providers have that that access to each other's records as it relates to patients, that that might help to make things more seamless. The communication on that part goes both ways. We have hospitals call up to say, oh, hey, your patient, Mr. Jones, is admitted. Can you give us some information about him? It's like, oh, that's where he is. He didn't show up to treatment today. We were wondering, we were trying to figure it out. Versus us knowing, oh, yeah, somebody, that person's in the hospital, I need to connect with either the case manager or the social worker there.
It's a little challenging sometimes because I have done that. I have called the dialysis unit and kind of scrambling, well, who's here? Why don't you not off today? Well, how do I? So it's just not a commonly accepted thing. And it's unfortunate it would be helpful. Yeah. And it's, so even as the case manager of the hospital making that phone call, I'm still not. And hearing what you're doing, I thought, well, shoot, you're doing all this work. Too bad it's not.
You don't know anything about it.
Right.
In acute care. Yeah.
And I think one of the things that would be most helpful, too, is if you gave your names to the local clinics so that then we would know who to contact. See, we call the hospital and we get the operator and we're trying to track down a case manager, to find out what's going on with someone. We don't even know where to begin.
Yeah. I'm a social worker. I've had mixed experiences. I've had some great experiences where I've actually gone to the hospital and have met with the team and help make ensure good discharge. And it's for better or for worse, because sometimes we know the patients longer. For instance, someone having major mental health issues and with them not presenting that way in the hospital. And so we're able to provide this information, but then it doesn't come up in the hospital, and then So I agree with you, though. I think it would be great. But like Jenna said, for people in hemodialysis, the hospitalizations, usually the nurse finds out. The nurse doesn't always tell the social worker. I work with peritoneal dialysis, so I'm a lot closer with the nurse. We have a log. I know where someone is, so I'm able to kind of connect that way. But it's different. I think
communication can change.
Yeah, and I definitely think it is room for improvement for both aspects of that you need to. And it could be if for example, I work really closely with the Kaiser Hospital down in the South Bay, and so having the connection there and knowing for this patient at this hospital, I know I have that person and she knows that I'm there, and we talk back and forth and have those conversations. With some of our other area hospitals, it's whoever happens to pick up the phone or whatever unit that person is on, and then they move units and it's a new contact person, so it's harder, I think, to get those relationships too. So it depends on, they're both, the dialysis clinic and hospitals are both organizations and systems in and of their own, their own piece, and it's about figuring out the best way to have that communication, because I think that communication is really important to have, because otherwise the two big systems working in silos and may not know that, oh, this is a patient who has been talking about wanting to stop, but their family's not wanting to let them stop, to use an example that we come up with a lot of the times, that but this patient's been cutting their treatment short because they don't want to be on dialysis anymore, but their family won't let them make that decision to stop. It would be, now they're in the ICU, it's kind of it's one of those events, right, to start have another goals of care conversation with the patients. And in the hospital, it might be different because now mom's really sick. Mom's on a ventilator, mom's in ICU, it's not the dialysis clinic saying mom keeps cutting her treatment short, it's a different situation.
And the family's driving the decisions then.
I don't know what, there's actually, I had a social worker call me from California Pacific Medical Center the other day to say, you know, are you still working at this clinic? We keep a log of all of the social workers in the nearby clinics, and then they give us that information of their social workers. So, it, I mean, it's a patient, so that's a great system. I don't know, like, what her role is, you know, and how she came to do that, but it's pretty awesome.
We just wanted to spend, I think, a bit of time on, I thought about doing these in three separate groups, but got carried away, so we will go ahead and get them together, but just in groups of three or four, have some discussions about how your IDT works well, or from, if you're not in a dialysis clinic setting, but in a hospital setting, you can even take it to your hospital team, because we are all in teams, how it works well. What challenges that that your team has, and ways to overcome those challenges, or here's what I've tried to overcome, I'd like some feedback on it. We'll do about, how much time do we have?
Until 4:10.
4:10. So we'll do about 20 minutes to go through those three questions, and then come back to it. So those are the three, and just,
Right, but then also like
insurance could play into it too, like the contracts. They might say, you're out of network.
All of them, right? And then like with the doubt.
Right, right.
And then how do you go before you have care?
And we have a whole day where we have back-to-back and IDTs that the patients come in, and now we have to see it.
Between the two of us, and we're both part-time. But it would be nicer if we had a
Some hospitals have like emergency management, like frequently.
In this case, the last
But sometimes
It would be so nice if we could just say no. Okay, so that's not going to be on Monday. So the other one on Monday. So I could go there by Tuesday. Let's do 2:30 because we'll talk about all the murder cases.
And this happens a lot, especially with the murder cases.
If the dietitian is not there and the customer is high, then I have to tell them, right?
As a nurse, I feel very confident doing that.
There's a handful that come just once a month, but there's most come at least twice, maybe three times. There's a lot of people come for
I learned a lot.
So how long? I think it helps to understand.
I think more so with the
Yeah, that's where we're.
So does anyone want to discuss some of the things that they found work well in their IoT team?
It works well for us.
What works well?
We just talked about that. I think they're a high functioning team. We have members that all participate and bring something to the table.
And that's excellent. Being a clinical services specialist, I go from clinic to clinic. So I go to their facility health meetings, FOPI. And I see everything from the very, very high functioning teams to the teams where it's just awful. You know, you can just see how the personalities are not getting along. And it's really fascinating because the places where I found where they don't have a high functioning team, they don't have good outcomes. They don't have good things happening in the clinic. It's really amazing. So what else have you found? What did you find works well? The fact that you all trust each other? Do you think it's trust?
And we have monthly set meetings, so we always know, mm-hmm. and it's always going to be that third Friday or that fourth Monday.
Uh-huh. And so you can come prepared.
Exactly.
So what did some of the rest of you find? Yes?
Inviting you to fall on my ear, probably only one that I need to do, but I'm on social media satellite dialysis.
Uh-huh.
I was kind of talking about how at my particular clinic previously our admin was doing the invitations for the patient for conferences, but I as a social worker am responsible for documenting that it was done, so I just kind of decided I don't want to take that on myself. And I haven't been doing it too long, but I found that I'm taking a little more time to explain what it's about. There's patients that have been there even for years and did never participate, didn't really understand what it was for. So just with that, we've had a lot more patients wanting to get part of that.
That's cool. And have you found that things are better with them by having them come to their care plan meetings?
I think that they really feel included, you know, and they can hear from everybody's perspective on, you know, how their care is going to ask questions, bring concerns, you know, I think it's
So, as I said, one of the things I do when I audit, one of the questions I ask the patients when I talk to them is, you know, are you invited to your care plan meetings? And they look at me like a deer caught in the headlight and go, what? No. And I was with a patient one day, and the charge nurse was at the computer, and I thought her eyes were going to fall out of her head. And she said, Mr. So-and-so, she said, yes, you are. Don't you remember I brought the paper over to you, and then you signed it and said you didn't want to go? And he goes, oh, that. So, you know, again, it's perception. You know, the words that I were using and the words that she had used to explain it to him were two different things, so he didn't understand what I was talking about. And I think that happens a lot. I think that, you know, a lot of times the way one person presents it is totally different than the way it was presented to them previously. So.
And I think, too, on that, it also is very different. Here, sign this versus this is what it is, this is why it's important, this is why we're inviting you to it. It's a very different way of approaching it, and tends to allow for more understanding than I have to sign another piece of paper, okay, signing it, not really knowing what it is.
And have you, yes, Erin?
Oh, no, go ahead.
No, no.
I was going to say a challenge. Challenge is actually with doctors sometimes. I think we have like these great docs that participate in the IDT, and we have like really thorough meetings with patients, and then there's some that like to silo themselves and they won't even want to talk to us on the phone, and they prefer everything to be communicated via fax. And you know, I think that really affects the patient's care because we're not all communicating, we're not all on the same page. The patient will go see the doc once a month, and there's no communication with all of us, and then, you know, all of a sudden the patient dies. Mm-hmm. And it's just like, I don't know if we could have prevented it, but I just, I think it's absurd how some docs are so averse to having, being, you know, involved and having, like, communication.
Indeed.
Because it obviously shows there's so much success in doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. In the hospital, you know, it's a little different. Some of our interdisciplinary teams are very open-ended and flexible. We just got called on two emergency ethics consults that we'll need to do on Monday, that you know, I'll need to run, and you have to force the doctors, all of the doctors, the specialists, everybody comes, the family. It's just an incredible thing. We always say, why didn't we do this sooner? You know, why did we wait for the chaos to happen? And of course, it would be marvelous. We can't. There's mm-hmm. no way we can do interdisciplinary teams on all of the patients and get everybody talking together, but it's just an incredible thing when it happens.
Right, yeah.
The communication is phenomenal.
Yeah, right? And it really would be nice if we could get everybody educated onto the same page.
Exactly.
But, you know, those of us that are in here are the people that want to do it. The people that need to hear this didn't come.
Exactly.
And that's the frustrating part. You know, we're all willing to do it, but we can't get the people that need to hear that here to hear it. So, well, moving forward.
Was there anything else first before?
No. Anything else anyone wanted to discuss?
any other strengths, challenges? Any thoughts of how to break through some of the challenges? How to overcome them? How to get through?
Yeah.
I think one of the challenges, I think it's great when the patients come, but like we were just talking about, sometimes the patients come and they think it's, you know, like a complete office visit.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they could take half hour or an hour just for one patient. So I think it needs to be made really clear to them what the purpose of that meeting is mm-hmm. and what our goals are.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that would work. So do you find when you, do you have them sign a paper that says that they're going to come or not come when they're invited?
Yes, our social worker would give them a paper and explain, like, oh, this is the day we're going to do it. You know, you want to come and then they sign a paper if they want to come. And then we also would post, you know, on our bulletin board, you know, for the month when the meetings were.
Okay. Because, yeah, I was going to say, the social worker could go into a little more detail to let them know that it's a brief meeting. It's not going to be, you know, 30 minutes.
And they do know. I think that was, it's been kind of from experience that, you know, before they did that, they would come and, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a great, I mean, the patients got a lot out of it, but if you have 30 patients.
Yes, you don't have an 8-hour day to do airplanes. Are there any other questions or things people would like to say? Okay, so the effective IDT is not just the care plan. It's taking care of the clinic and the outcomes on a daily basis. It's keeping the pulse of the clinic to understand when they need to intervene versus to escalate an issue to the clinic manager. And so it's just trying to keep an even keel with your clinic. So your IDT team takes care of your patients, and then that core team of people, when the physician isn't there, disseminates that out to the rest of the team so that you have a well-functioning and well-run clinic that has good outcomes. That's it.
Just like that.
Just like that.